Hey guys, so this is, I think, maybe going to be the last part in this series. I don't know because I'm just starting to film it now. I've been trying to keep them to an hour, but the last one went over an hour, so this one I hope won't do that. Anyway, so on this one, I'm doing more of the clay washes. So right now, I just gloss coated this. I did it actually wee hours of the morning last night. I did this, so it's all nice and shiny now, and ready for the next thing I got to do. The last time you saw it, I had just finished sealing it with a flat coat, I think, and then doing the dot filter, which you can still sort of see through the gloss. But one of the things about gloss coats and flash coats, when you have your model painted in base paint and you spray a gloss coat on it, it will darken. It's just the effect of the gloss coat. It darkens the paint. When you spray the flat coat on it, it lightens it again. So when you're doing that, don't freak out because your paint suddenly has changed color, because it'll come back when you put the dull coat on, or flat coat, or matte coat, whatever it is you want to call it. So right now it has darkened again because I put the gloss over it, and some of the dot filtering is a little bit harder to see because of the gloss coat. But once I put the flat coat back on after I'm done this wash, it'll come back. So not to worry, as they say. Now the next thing I'm going to do is put on a clay base wash, and this one consists of some UMP light dirt and UMP's, I don't have a label for this one, UMP's earth wash mixed together. The light dirt was just a little bit too light. It was a very yellowy sand color when it dries. I mixed the two of them together. It's more of a browny color, which is what I want. Because what I'm doing now is basically ground in dust and dirt is what I'm doing. So I'm going to add it the same way that I did the other wash. I'm going to put it everywhere, and then I'm going to take it back so that when I take it back, it's stuck in all the raised and recessed detail, just like the dark dirt was. Now the dark dirt will still be visible, but it will have the dirt over it, like the dirt wash that I'm doing now. The dark dirt, this is where some of the terminology gets a little difficult to understand because the names of the products are so similar. The dark dirt, the purpose of that wash was to imply shadow and accentuate detail. Okay, that was the whole purpose of that wash. The whole purpose of this wash, which is the light dirt wash, is to actually add weathering. Now, weathering at this point means adding anything like dirt, dust, mud, accumulated grime, oil, that kind of thing, where environmental effects like rust and stains and stuff like that, those are... they're also considered weathering, but they're a different part of weathering. And then you have the lighting effects, such as panel lines and pre-shading and post-shading and that sort of thing. They're all part of the weathering process in a way, but very loosely. But strictly, weathering is actually adding dirt and doing the rust and oil stains and aging your vehicle. So you're implying a certain age to your vehicle. That's what weathering is. So you're either making it look new or you're making it look old, and you're using a weathering process to do that. So that's what that is. And so the purpose of the dark dirt was to add lighting effects, which is aside from the weathering. Some people still consider it to be part of it, but most people that I know don't. I want this to be pretty much as everywhere as I can get. You can already see it's starting to dry in some places. Now, the earth, the UMP's earth, dries a little slower than most of the washes that they make, I found. I don't know why. It just does. That's not a big deal. Takes about maybe 25 minutes longer, depending on how thick you put it on. I don't usually put it on too thick. So, but that's good because that allows you to work with it longer before it dries completely out. But even with the other washes, you still have plenty of time. And they are water soluble, so you can just reactivate them if you need to with a little bit of water or just add more wash. So this wash that I'm putting on here is meant to represent all the accumulated road dust and dirt that gets in all the nooks and crannies as this thing, you know, diddy bops around the roadside or around the countryside doing its thing. And so when I go to take this off, a lot of it will be coming off and it won't be stuck in every single surface. But when I apply it like I'm doing now, I want to make sure I get it everywhere so that I have the option to remove it from every single surface. Just for me anyway, it makes it easier to determine what I want to remove and what I don't when it's all on. If I add it in little bits and pieces, it kind of looks a little jigsaw puzzle-y to me. And I've never really cared much for that sort of appearance. So I just noticed that this bogey right there and this bogey right here are on upside down. Just noticed that. I'll have to, I don't think I can take them off, put them back on the right way around. So I'll have to cover them up. It's just the only reason you can tell is because the little slider here, there's a little slider tray right here, a little guard, is on the wrong side. Instead of on the top, it's on the bottom. That's how I noticed it. nearly done. Get it up underneath the sponsons there. Most people can't see underneath there, but this thing is going to be sitting on the back of a dragon wagon in a slightly elevated position. So you're probably going to be able to see a little bit under here. So I'll make sure there's a bit of dust and grime in there. The bottom as well, for the same reason. And normally I wouldn't bother weathering the bottom of the vehicle simply because you can't see it. And paint costs money, and if I don't have to paint something, I won't. A lot of that comes from I don't like painting. So, but there's a lot of guys, including me, that subscribe to I'll know it's there. And but in this situation, I don't need to know it's there. I don't care. I don't usually paint the bottoms. But like I said, in this situation, you will be able to see some of this because it's in an elevated position in the back of the dragon wagon. So it'll be somewhat visible. So that's why I'm adding it. That. actually start to see it starting to dry in there. That's the color. That's the final color right there. It'll be that. And but when I go back at this with a brush or with a cotton bud and take it off, I'll probably leave most of it in the lower area here because I'll be building this up with more mud and dust and everything here. But most of it will be taken off on the upper surfaces. The trick is doing it without leaving a line between the where you stop the weathering. You gotta try and avoid doing that. Straight lines don't work very well when it comes to mud. So, have to be careful with that. But I'll show you how to do splattering and stuff like that, which helps blend all that stuff together. Only takes a few seconds to do all that stuff too. And with these pigments, it makes it even easier because it's really fast. The exhaust on these things is up in here. That's what these two little rigs here is. So there'll be some exhaust staining in this region here when I'm done. I'll do that with some pigments. Like I said, almost all of this will be taken off on the upper surfaces, so I don't have to go too crazy on patterning or anything like that. But I do have to make sure that I get it everywhere, because the dust and dirt and everything settles all over everything. Got to keep stirring up the pigment too. Incidentally, that's what it looks like sitting in the cup, mixed up. It's like a chocolate brown color before you put it on. And to test to make sure you got the right color, I'll show you. I will take it and paint it on a dark surface like this. This is the light dirt just painted on. Just paint that on, and then I take my airbrush and I dry it right quick. It takes like 15 seconds, if that. And then I'll see their true color. And I say, oh, that's too light. So then I added some UMP earth to it and sprayed it. And yeah, that's the color dried to. And I say, yeah, it's still a little bit too light. Add a little bit more, and that's the third color that it came to. And that's the color I decided on. So that's how I figured out what color to use, in case you wondered. Just try not to knock the camera over again. It was weird, the camera leg just gave right out. It's one of those little ones that you twist and lock them into place. Just a cheap little camera stand that came with an old telescope that I have. And the thing just decided, I'm done. And the whole camera, everything fell over. It's not good. Gotta be careful with that camera, because that camera's been through a lot. Wasn't long ago, almost the exact same thing happened, where I dropped this camera into a cup of my coffee. The whole camera went right into a cup of coffee. And this is like a $1,700 camera. So dropping that into a cup of coffee was, as you can understand, a little annoying. And I was in a bit of a tizzy over that for quite some time, because I thought that was the end of the camera. But I put it in some in a big thing of rice. I had a big thing of basmati rice upstairs in the kitchen. So I took it upstairs. Somebody suggested that I do this. I don't remember who it was now. Sorry about that. But yeah, somebody suggested that I do that. I took it upstairs and put it in a big container of rice, and I left it there for about 2 weeks. So I was only able to make videos with my iPad and stuff like that, which sucked, because iPads are terrible for that. And so it was up there for 2 weeks, and I pulled it out and turned it on, gave it a try, and it worked, which totally blew my mind. I didn't think the thing would, because it was soaked like all the way through. But now the thing, all it does is fry batteries. I can't unplug it because the battery is, they just go dead. I don't know why, but it eats them. So the batteries are no good in them, in the camera now. And I've bought a couple of new batteries for it to see if that was the actual problem, and it just killed the battery right away. So there's some kind of thing or short or something in there that's frying the battery. So I can't take the camera and walk around with it for longer than a couple of seconds because it'll just shut off. So I have to warm the camera up before I make a video. So I have to take the camera down, turn it on, and let it sit with it plugged in, turned on for a minute or two, so that the battery charges up enough that the camera can record and the little display comes on. So once that's done, I can record for hours and hours and hours. I just can't unplug the camera. I mean, that's fine. The only thing I use the camera for is this. It's making YouTube videos. I don't use it for anything else. But it was originally for videotaping my kids and stuff like that, but my wife and I aren't so good at doing that. We tried to use it at Christmas there this year, but it just decided it wasn't going to work. So I went and bought another camera at one point, but it is too old. I can't connect it to the computer without this really specific base that you have to buy. And they don't make the base anymore, and you can't buy the base separately. You have to buy the camera and the base together. And when I bought the camera, I didn't know that. I just bought the camera. So the camera's no good to me at all. So it's kind of annoying. It's a nice camera, too. Nice Sony. It worked fine for an hour or two, and then I realized I couldn't get any of the film off it. It's kind of annoying. Well, right. So that is what it looks like now. It's a little bit scary. It doesn't look too bad, though. But once that dries, that's about the color it'll look like. But most of this will be taken off. It'll only be stuck in the details and stuff like that when it's done. Except for down around the running gear. I'll probably leave a lot more of it down there than I will anywhere else, because it implies the kind of the background for the mud and stuff. I'm not going to be going crazy with the mud on it. There'll be some, but there's not going to be like huge chunks and sod and crap like that stuck in there. It'll be a bit, but not tons. So that'll be the next thing that I do. Just try not to break that antenna. It's like the third one I had to put in there. I keep losing them. Some people like to wait until the end to put the antennas on, but I put them on and then just break them, because I like doing that. I don't like gluing things on after paint and everything's on. I don't like marring the surface with glue. I don't like the risk that comes with it, so I don't do it. I will put everything on and paint it all together, like with the stowage there. All that stowage is already on there, and then I paint it by hand, right? And every time I do it, I get better and better and better at doing it, so it's a practice thing. So it's a good skill to learn, learning how to increase your skills on base painting and stuff like that, detail painting. And doing that actually helped me with my figure painting, learning how to do that. So it's not a bad idea. But a lot of guys building their vehicles, they take everything off and put it all on cocktail sticks and paint it up that way. And there's some builds I do that, right? But when it comes to stowage and stuff, no, I paint that in place. It's just too much of a pain in the butt to do it the other way. I am far too lazy. But the thing is, though, you don't have to. You can paint it in place just like that. There's no reason why you shouldn't be able to do that. It's perfectly fine. So, and it's a good skill building thing. So anyway, so this is done, and it's going to take probably about an hour and a half to dry. Like I said, the earth dries a little slower, so I'm going to give it a little bit of time. And then I'll come back when it's done and show you how to take it off. Okie doke. So, we're going to be taking off a bit of the wash. This is what it looks like right now. It's pretty dirty and it's very, very dry. There's no wet spots left on there. It's been on there for a while now, a couple hours at least. And that's what it will look like once it's taken off. I've already done the turret. It's just basically there's like a small amounts of ground in brownish dust, dirt here and there. Just enough to add, well, basically a worn, dirty look. It's kind of all I'm going for, just to caked in dirt. Ground into the nooks and crannies and stuff. And then after that I'll seal it all with a flat coat, and then I'm going to do more of this but over the flat. So now taking it off is the same as with the dark dirt. Take it off in streaks. So you're taking your cotton bud and getting in there as nice and tight as you can. Dragging it down the sides, mimicking the way water would flow over the vehicle as best you can. I can't remember if I mentioned this in the other parts of the video series or not, but you can get better quality cotton buds than just the cheap ones you get at your grocery store, namely the Tamiya ones. But the Tamiya ones are, like I think I might have actually said this, but not sure. So I remember talking to somebody about this not long ago. But the Tamiya ones are about $10.99 a box for a box of 100, and it costs $14 for shipping to get them here from the closest possible place. And that's just for 100 cotton buds, which would last me one vehicle, I think. Probably not even that, depending on the size of the vehicle. Something like the size of, like, the 72nd scale Millennium Falcon by fine molds. I'd need about 8. It took me, I'd say 2,000-3,000 cotton buds to do that one. So I need quite a few, whereas a box of these cheap little guys costs $3.99 plus 15% tax. That's considerably cheaper. And yeah, they fray a bit and you get little fuzzies here and there stuck on little bits and pieces, but once you go around and take the wash off, go around with a pair of tweezers and pull them off, and save yourself a lot of money. Well, I'd be saving myself a lot of money, because like I said, those packages of Tamiya ones are brutally expensive. That's why I don't use them, because they cost too freaking much, and you only get a few in the box. Now, if it was like $10.99 for a box of 2,000, well, then I definitely would buy them. But that isn't the case. So basically, like I had shown with the dark dirt, you go around the cotton bud and you take off everything that's in the open areas, and you leave everything that's in the nooks and crannies. So that There's a nice ground in dirt look pretty much everywhere. Probably going to take me 45 minutes to do this, which I won't film. I'm only going to film a couple of minutes of this, and then I'll move on to the next part, because you've already seen me do this. But the dark dirt, because it's the exact same process. There's really no difference. The difference will be in the result, which you'll see in just a few minutes. So basically, yeah, I'll be going around this thing with the cotton buds and clean it all up, and then I'll seal it with a flat coat and start the next bit. So I'll be back in a minute. Okay, so I've taken the wash off now, and as you can see, it's looking all cleaned up now. Still got the gloss on there, haven't done anything else. Now the next thing I do, I just did it to the turret here. Let's see, take a medium stiff bristle brush and I clean up anything that looks like it's overdone. Like the areas that I couldn't quite get with the cotton bud, or areas that were there's just more accumulation than you really want. I mean, it's fairly easy to just brush it off. It's dust, so it's, you know, fairly easy to clean up. As you can see there, it's a fairly simple thing to do, fairly simple procedure. It's looking a bit better. Now when I hit that with the flat coat, that'll all blend in quite a bit. So do a bit more on this. I haven't done anything on this yet. Now what this does is it reduces the concentration. It's still accumulated in all the little nooks and crannies, but it's not as stark. It softens it. So it looks more ground in. That's kind of the effect that you're going for. And there's lots of little areas that are really hard to get in with the cotton bud, like in there. It's really hard to get in there. I haven't cleaned anything up there, but you can still see a lot of the little fuzzies from the cotton bud in there. This will also help get rid of some of those. See, it's accumulated all in there along the bottom edge. That's exactly the effect you're going for. And you use a medium soft bristle brush so you don't knock off your photo edge. You don't want to snap that off because that's a pain in the butt to fix. I'm going to continue going around this, pretty much doing what I'm doing right now, and then I'm going to come back and flat coat the vehicle and blend in this effect, and then I'll start some more washes with the more like mud and dirt and grime for the lower down around this area here. That'll be the next thing. So there's already some in there from the wash I just did. See if I can get the glare off. And you can see it built up in there. It's all around the rivets that are in there. And then the bits and pieces of the bogey. I'll build up in there with another color. And probably do a little bit of wet work. To show a little bit of like water or grease that's flowing through the dust and grime that's collected under there. So that'll be next. So I'll clean this up and I'll be back. So this is now flat coated with the tester's dull coat. That's the matte coat that I usually use for pretty much everything now. And you can see the wash collected in there. That's actually the easiest place to see it. It's also on top of all the heads of the bogies and stuff, and it's ground into the detail on there, and there'll be more built up as I go further on with the weathering. See the other side there. So the next thing I'm going to do is another wash. And this one is going to be all just down here, along here. And it's going to be more, it's not really going to be much of a wash. It's going to be more of a splattering effect. I'll sponge it on to the flat coat with a brush, and then wait a little while for it to dry, and then take it off with a very stiff brush. It'll be a different color than what's already in there. Not much, but a different color, just to show either a later applied or early applied layer of dirt and grime and dust. And then after that, we'll go on with the mud. The mud will also get all collected in here, and then I will take a brush and flick it and splatter it up along the sides. And then after that, I switch back to oils and do the grease and oil stains. So, and that's pretty close to being done by then. The only thing I have to do after that is the glasswork, which is these little visors. This little periscope here, and then a periscope there, and a periscope there, and the two periscopes here, right? And then after that, I dry brush any of the metal that I want to have shined up. And the color I use, usually, I have no idea what it actually is anymore, but it's MIG's gunmetal, I think it is. I don't know what the number is. But either way, that's the color that I use. It's nice and dull. It's not shiny. You don't want to have any shiny metal. Shiny metal doesn't look realistic. So you go with a dull color. If you don't have the paint to do it, an HB pencil will do it. In fact, I use both, depending on, because sometimes I can't get the brush in there, so I use the tip of an HB pencil and do the same thing. So that's pretty much it for this. This is going to have to dry for a few hours, and then I'll come back with the next bit. So. Okay, so I'm going to be adding the UMP earth to the undercarriage here. This is the first of the colors that I'm going to add. It's quite dark. It's a very dark chocolate brown. You can see by the way it's dried around the rim there. That's actually the color that it will settle at. And I only want it on the underside here, along the hull side and underside of the sponsons. Don't want it everywhere though. Just splattering here and there. Use the bristles pushing in on an upward angle like this, so that the bristles make a splayed fan. You don't want a nice even row either. You want a jagged up-down type of patterning. All this is meant to do is represent the coloring along the back of the wall. I'm going to build up some mud later. There's a message from somebody. I'm going to build up some mud later. Not much, just a little. And it'll cover up Not all of this, some of it, but it'll be mixed in. So that it all, well, it's supposed to be blended together. At least that's what I'm hoping anyway. And that's the thing, though. It's always hoping. I do this the same way, pretty much, every time. But I'm never totally sure how it's going to work out. And then when it's done, I'm always surprised. So I put this on using this brush here. And then I come back with the stiff bristle brush, and I don't take all of it off. I take some or most of it off. Now, the stiff bristle brush will also help me blend a lot of it. So it's not so clean, sharp-edged. It'll be more of a smooth edge, and I'll show you that when it comes time. Everything under here will be quite well hidden, and it'll be very dark, but I'm going to add it anyway in case some of it is visible. And once I put this dark on, I'm going to come back with some light dirt and add another layer of color for some of the drier earth. Won't be putting that everywhere, it'll only be in a few spots. This stuff I'm pretty much putting everywhere though, underneath here anyway. Splatter effect that mud has, I'll be coming back and adding that later. You don't have to worry about that during this. That's something I'll add using something completely different. It'll be actually this color, most likely, but it'll be a different effect that I'll be using. Different procedure anyway, not a different effect. Sorry about that. Done. Now it'll take about maybe 25-30 minutes for this to dry. This is the earth, so like I'd said before, it takes a little longer for the earth to dry. Not sure why. think it probably has maybe a bit more pigment in it than the other ones. Not really sure. It is a hell of a lot darker, like more rich than the other washes. It's actually rapidly becoming my favorite one. I really like the color. It's really good for mixing too. So I found lots of good uses for it. That's all I'm going to do for that. I'll let that sit and dry, like I said, for about 20 minutes or so. And then I will come back and hit it with the stiff bristled brush, which is that. It's an old ox hair stippling brush. That's a little Coen one, so it's actually a pretty good quality one. But that's any old stippling brush. That's like a relatively firm bristles will do. You could probably even do it with a piece of this green scouring pad on a pair of tweezers. It'll probably do the same job. You could probably even rub it off with a cotton bud. It'd probably be very hard on the cotton bud though. You could still do it. You probably even do it with your finger. Your finger would be very difficult to get in there, though. So, lots of different ways to do it. Anyway, I'll be back in a minute. Okay, let's hope this isn't getting too long. I have a suspicion that it might be. But this will be the last bit. This will be quick. Okay, stiff bristle brush. Wash is now dry. You can see it on there. It's quite a dark, earthy brown. Kind of a reddish, rusty plow field kind of thing. So you take the brush and literally just give it a rub. Not too much because you don't want to take it off. But you want to take off the harsh edge that sits around the outline. You don't want you don't want this nice, neat, clean edge. You want it more of a stain and less of a paintbrush mark. So that's pretty much what you're trying to do. This is just the first layer. Not much that needs to be done down below here. Mostly you're just putting in streak marks. If you see a sharp edge, you take it off. Now a lot of what's down here is going to get covered anyway by more weathering and mud and pigments and stuff that you're going to come in here. It may sound like a lot more is left to do, but it's not. It's not as much as you think. It's really only maybe a few hours, if that work. Don't want to scrub too hard because you don't want to take any paint off. So don't push. Just let the bristles do the work. So you don't have to push in with your hand. Just let the tip of the brush do all the work. You don't have to worry about the stuff rubbing off or anything like that later on. It's on there quite well. It's pretty firmly attached. As you can tell, I have to, in order to take it off, I have to use a stiff bristled brush. Once it gets on that flat surface, it's pretty much on there for forever. It's not coming off too easily. Sharp edge on it, and now it's nice and smooth. I don't know if you how well you can see that on the camera. See, when I film these, I'm looking at a screen that's about maybe 4 inches wide and 2 inches tall. But when I watch these back, they're on a monitor that's, you know, 22 inches across, and I watch it on full screen. So I can see a lot better, but when I'm filming it, it's different. So I don't know exactly what it is you guys can see. It's very difficult sometimes. And this, most of this, one take. You don't really get a chance to get another take, unfortunately. That's just the way of it. So that's done. That's about how long that took. So it took about maybe 5 minutes to put on, maybe 10, and 3 minutes to take it off, maybe five. So that's that bit. Now, the next thing I'll do is another layer with the light dirt, right? That'll go on. I might darken that. I got a mixed one here that I'll probably use. It's basically some of this and some of the earth put in it, and I'll just put little bits of it in front here and there, and then I'm going to do the mud on the lower area here, and then the pigments are done, or the washes are done, and then after that it's pigments. And the pigments, they're going to be a little bit up here, a little bit up on top of the turret, mostly around the crew area, a little bit around here on top of the flat surfaces, and then we'll do some mud splattering on the back sides here, and then I'll do the oil work for the stains, and it'll be done. So, but that'll be the next video. So you guys be good, keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.